Thank you. Good morning. I'm Sheldon. This is Sandy.
He's my alter ego.
The original plan for this morning was that I was asked to interview Sandy and ask her questions and have her answer, but folks who know me know that I'm incapable of not weighing in. And so what we're going to try to do is just start a conversation and hopefully be able to address a lot of the issues that are on your minds, both about what's happening at the national level with the Affordable Care Act, and then I want to make sure we don't forget what's happening here in Kansas, because if you saw the table outside, we have a very important bill coming up for a vote in a committee on Monday in Kansas dealing with expansion of the Medicaid program. I understand that folks have index cards, so if you have questions, write them on the cards, and I guess somebody will collect them and bring them down to us. So I guess, Sandy, the best way to start is to just get right into it and ask you if it's true that the Affordable Care Act has been a dismal failure.
I guess that's one of those alternative reality issues that one has to deal with. No, it has not. We have seen uninsured rates, the lowest in modern history, maybe since the invention of insurance back after World War II. Especially in states that expanded Medicaid, the drop in uninsured rates in those states is at between 35 and 40%. Not as much in states like Kansas that did not expand Medicaid, because that was a big portion of the safety net. It was carefully crafted. This was a very carefully crafted piece of legislation that I think members of Congress obviously have found out that it's not as easy to unravel as they thought it might be, because we still don't have a plan that is doable. There are features of it that, if they are not in place, like the mandate, it really makes it very difficult for insurance companies to be able to provide affordable products on the exchange. But bottom line is, more people are insured today. That means more people are getting the healthcare services they need. And to that extent, it has been, it has done what it was supposed to do. Get more people insured, get more people with access to healthcare.
So, so here's the part where I'm just gonna add stuff rather than ask another question. So, you know, I've been working, going around the state for the last 6 years talking about the Affordable Care Act, and most of what we talk about is what Sandy just talked about, is how it affects the number of people who have insurance and are able to get health care. You know, there's a reason the bill was more than 900 pages long. It's because it addresses a lot of other things, too, that we often overlook. And so when policy wonks like Sandy and I get together and talk about healthcare, we talk about things like access, quality, and cost. And those things are all related. And so the Affordable Care Act also tried to improve the quality of care that our healthcare providers are able to provide, and also to bring down the growth in the cost of care, which has been out of control for a long time. So I always like to talk about, you know, the mythology around healthcare is that this is the greatest health system in the world. And it's certainly true that we put more money into our health system than anywhere else in the world, but we don't get better results. In fact, if you look at the results we get in terms of quality and outcomes, we rank somewhere about in the middle of the rest of the developed world. And for spending this much money, we ought to be getting better results. And with my apologies to any healthcare providers who may be out in the audience, quality of care in the health system in the United States is dismal. It is abysmal. The folks who die because of harm caused by the healthcare system, things like going into the hospital and getting an infection, or going to the hospital not being monitored and falling out of bed, that's the third leading cause of death in the United States. Now, it's not reported that way because what gets reported is the disease that someone died of. But if you were actually to add all those up, after heart disease and cancer, medical harm would be the third leading cause of death in the United States. And so clearly there's something about our system that is not incentivizing providers to provide quality care. And that is not to say they're not trying, but they have traditionally worked within a system that has not rewarded quality. Healthcare providers have always gotten paid for the amount of services they provide. Whether they do them well or not has never been part of the equation. In fact, there has been good research that showed that before the Affordable Care Act, hospitals that made mistakes made higher profits than hospitals that didn't, because they got paid for making the mistake, and then they got paid for fixing the mistake. Well, the ACA has started to change that, and it's moving us very quickly, as a matter of fact, towards a system that tries to reward outcomes and quality. That's very difficult to do. We don't even really know how to measure quality and outcomes at the same time we're trying to move payment systems to reward them. But we have seen some huge changes. And so since 2011, when some of these changes took effect, the proportion of people that are harmed in hospitals has gone down by about 20%, which means that about 50,000 lives have been saved and more than $10 billion in healthcare costs have been saved. The other thing that I want to quickly point out is cost. And Sandy, she has something to say, so I'll pitch it to her in a second. But otherwise, I'll forget what I'm going to say if I don't keep going. So the cost of care has also been a problem. We spend more on healthcare in this country by far than any other developed country in the world. It is an increasing part of our gross domestic product. It is the main reason we have federal budget deficits. Cost growth has also, while it's still growing too fast, has come under better control under the Affordable Care Act. It is not growing at the rate that it used to. And so,
just not to pile on healthcare providers, I thought perhaps as the spouse of a healthcare provider here in Lawrence, Kansas for many, many years, I want to add, I agree with what Sheldon is saying. One of the flaws in our healthcare payment system is the fee-for-service system that we have operated under, which essentially pays more, you get paid more for doing more, not for doing right. And that's been one of the major contributing factors to growth in healthcare costs. So the Affordable Care Act did create these accountable care organizations, which Sheldon referenced, which really has helped to bring the quality of care to where it needs to be, focusing on outcomes and not on just doing more to get paid more. And I always like to tell a story about Mark, my husband, who was on call one weekend in the emergency room. This really illustrates what I'm talking about. Three people came in that weekend with what he diagnosed as appendicitis based on his talking to the patient, looking at lab tests. It's routine to order a CAT scan for anyone who comes into an emergency room with belly pain. But Mark said, the CAT scan's, $1,500? I don't need it because it's not going to change what I plan to do. These people, I'm pretty sure, have appendicitis. So he canceled the CAT scans. One got done before he could get it canceled. The other two were canceled. All three did, in fact, have appendicitis. The one CAT scan came back normal. So that patient, had he relied on the CAT scan, might have gone home, only to have come back later with perhaps even a ruptured appendix, which can be life-threatening. So the point is, doctors in a system where it's fee-for-service are incentivized to go ahead and order the test. If insurance was going to pay for it, it's, you know, nobody's harmed, essentially, and the hospital gets revenue from the CAT scan that it has and needs to use if it's going to justify the payment and the purchase of the CAT scan. So part of the Affordable Care Act really is bigger than just getting people covered. It really is bringing our healthcare system into a much more of a coordinated system. I think you're seeing that all across the country as doctors and hospitals consolidate practices, which is a good thing. It means that everyone's working towards the same goal, and that's making sure that that patient gets the best possible care and with the least amount of medical intervention, if that's possible. They go hand in hand. Quality of care and cost containment go hand in hand. Better care is less costly. It's a proven fact. It maybe doesn't sound It may sound counterintuitive, but it is. And so what might be lost with the Affordable Care Act being overturned is some of these projects which are having such really dramatic impact on the cost of care. Quite frankly, I don't think those projects will go away, even if the Affordable Care Act does, because they are so successful, you're going to see a continued alignment. And it's not just doctors and hospitals, but it's also the payer, the insurance company, who up until now has really been chastised anytime they tried to step into the equation and deny a test, deny coverage for something that perhaps the doctor or the hospital was authorizing. The accountable care organizations create a system where if outcomes are improved and costs are contained, the resulting savings is shared with everyone across the board. The insurance company wins, the healthcare, the hospital is compensated through bonuses as well as the physician. So it we are moving in the right direction in that regard, and I think that's a good thing.
Okay, so Sandy, questions are starting to come in, and a lot of people are asking about what we might expect Congress to do in terms of repealing and replacing the Affordable Care Act. So let me jump to one of the first ones. A lot of questions about, we're hearing a lot about high-risk pools, which is where the sickest people in the population, essentially people who have never been able to buy insurance because of pre-existing conditions, are segregated into their own pool. So can you explain what those are and how they work and what you think we might be seeing with those?
Sure, we had a high-risk pool in Kansas before the Affordable Care Act passed, and we dissolved it. We, the insurance department, dissolved it because it wasn't necessary. But the premiums were high. The deductible, the amount you had to pay out of pocket before the high deductible plan kicked in, that deductible was very high, and for many families would have been a deal breaker, causing personal bankruptcy, which of course is the highest reason, the number one reason for personal bankruptcy in America is medical bills. So they are not a solution. They are not a solution. They've worked in a few states, but the state has to kick in a lot of resources, a lot of dollars. Those dollars have to be collected from somebody, and oftentimes it's either through tax increases or subsidies or ways of collecting it from the other insurance companies that then help pay into that high-risk pool. So it drives up the cost for everybody else. It's really kind of a smokescreen. It is not a solution. The high-risk pools are not a solution.
So let me just add to that for a second and to back up a little bit. And because a lot of this relies on a basic understanding of what insurance is and how it works, which unfortunately it seems to be lacking in Congress and the Kansas legislature. So the whole idea of insurance is we put a lot of people in a big pool, everybody kicks in a little bit of money, so that when the few people in the pool get sick, there is money to cover them. The idea behind health insurance is no different than auto insurance. So I'm gonna do a little thing. How many in this room have auto insurance? How many in the last year have made a claim and collected? Okay, turn around to all your neighbors that don't have their hands up and thank them. That's how insurance works. And so the idea of a high-risk pool is we're going to take all those people that crashed their cars last year and segregate them off by themselves, which means that everyone else left may well pay less for their insurance because those bad drivers aren't going to be in the pool anymore. But then what happens to those other folks? They are the highest cost people in the system. We've brought them all together into one pool. And so what you get is an insurance plan that has very, very high costs, high premiums, high deductibles, as Sandy was said. Traditionally, only a small fraction of the people that would be segregated into a high-risk pool can actually afford to be in it. And that's even with state and federal subsidies to support it. And so the amount of government money that would be necessary to support a high-risk pool and make it affordable for the people who are in it is astronomical. What Paul Ryan and others in Congress are proposing is not even close to what it would cost. And so essentially what we're doing is segregating sick people out of the system and telling them you don't get the care you need.
Absolutely right.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about, short of repealing the ACA, obviously it's not perfect. So what are some things you think that need to be fixed that could be repaired maybe short of just getting rid of the whole thing?
Well, I'm not sure that's going to be an option because I think they're going much further than that. But when the law was being, the bills were being debated in Congress, and our National Association had the opportunity to weigh in frequently. Insurance has never been regulated at the federal level. It's a state-regulated entity. Even with the Affordable Care Act and exchanges, a lot of the oversight of the insurance companies was retained at the state level. One of the things that we pointed out was there in the Affordable Care Act, there are rating bands to keep people to make sure that some people aren't charged way more than others. The rating bands that are in the law currently it's a 3-to-1 rating band, meaning that young people can't be charged less than a third of what older people are charged. Well, at the time, we argued that perhaps initially they should think about broadening those age bands, because you didn't want to price younger, healthier people out of the market, which is exactly what has happened. We know that the highest number of uninsured still is in that 19 to 34 age range. So they didn't listen to us. In fact, I like to joke about the fact that I was the one who carried the message to the Senate Health Committee, arguing, at that time they were looking at 4-to-1, and I was arguing that perhaps they should think about going to 5 or even 6-to-1, so that, and Ron Wyden from Oregon said, you mean, Commissioner, you think that older people should have to pay 5 or 6 times what younger people have to pay? And I said, well, Senator, you know, in the current system, if they can even buy insurance, I can guarantee you it's probably even more than that. So yes, I am saying that because I think younger, healthier people, you want in the pool, as Sheldon pointed out. You want a big pool. You want a lot of healthy people in the pool that are not using the services to help offset the cost of those who need them. Well, instead of staying at 4-to-1, they went to 3-to-1, so I wasn't a very good messenger. And I think that is one of the things. If they ever got serious about taking the law as it is today and making some changes to it that might be doable, I don't think that's going to happen. I mean, we're already hearing that high-risk pools are in the equation. My favorite is selling across state lines. Oh my. when someone argues that, you know they have not a clue about how insurance works. Number one, a company is not going to want to come into a state and market their products if they have a healthy pool. And you as a state wouldn't want someone coming into your state with an insurance company that has an unhealthy pool, so that you can get those healthy people in the state. Let's say somebody from Missouri wants to sell in Kansas. Let's say theoretically we have a healthier pool of citizens, and they have an unhealthy book of business in Missouri. They want to come over here to help offset their cost. Well, you know, number one, that wouldn't be good for us. And in most cases, the insurance companies are going to be looking at a state where they have a better chance to make more money and have a better book of business. So selling across state lines just doesn't make sense. It's not doable. The other is, as I said, insurance is regulated at the state level. Our legislature now. Some of the benefits have been more standardized, but there are still differences from state to state on the benefits that are covered by the health plan. So a product is approved in another state, they bring that product to Kansas, they compete against the products that have originated in Kansas, that have benefits that were established by the Kansas legislature, and they would be competing unfairly. And what kind of a product is going to come in to compete unfairly? It's not going to be one that offers more benefits at greater cost. It's going to be one that offers fewer benefits at lesser cost. That, coming back to the notion of the big pool, that segments the market. That pulls those younger, healthier folks out of the market, causing the folks that stay in the pool for the Kansas insured products to pay more. And there's a kind of a clever term for that in insurance jargon. It's called a death spiral. And it means that as the younger, healthier folks don't buy the policies, it's more expensive for those who stay in, and gradually they can't afford them and they drop out. So it's so selling across state lines is just jargon for they don't know what they're doing.
I don't think I can probably say it any better than that, but as usual, I'm going to add something to it anyway. So just a couple of things about selling across state lines. So I was talking to a reporter, an AP reporter a week ago, who is working on an article about selling across state lines, who is making the rounds of trying to call every insurance commissioner in the U.S. to ask about it. She's made it through more than half of them, Republicans, Democrats, appointed, elected, however they get into the job. She hasn't found one yet who's in favor of it.
Not surprised.
The second thing is that there's nothing that prohibits insurance companies from selling across state lines today. And so, in fact, if states sign interstate agreements with each other, they can do that. There are several states out there, Georgia, South Carolina, a few others, that have invited insurance companies from other states into their state to sell products. And they have had a total of exactly zero insurance companies take them up on the offer. And one of the reasons is very simple. So one of the most costly things an insurance company has to do when it comes into a new state is create a network of providers for that insurance company. So it sounds theoretically like a great idea to get great competition and get more insurance companies selling, but if you live here in Kansas and you buy a policy of an insurance company in Georgia, it's not going to help you to have a network of providers that are in Atlanta. And that is fundamentally the problem with selling across state lines. So, Sandy, another thing that has been touted as an answer to the problems are health savings accounts. And so if you could talk maybe a little bit about health saving accounts and what they are, and I'm sure I'll have something to add to it.
Well, a health savings account, number one, presumes you have money that you can put into the savings account and set it aside to pay for medical expenses, including some of those high deductibles. So oftentimes the health savings account is paired with a high deductible plan, and you can use then this money from the savings account. It's put in with pre-tax dollars, and you can pull it out if you're using it for authorized medical expenses without any kind of a tax consequence. So on the surface it sounds good, but the problem that it overlooks is that people have to have disposable income to establish their savings account in the first place. So it only works for folks who really don't need them. To me, that's the biggest problem. I'm sure Sheldon has some additional things to say, but the bottom line is, if you can establish a health savings account, you have sufficient resources to make all kinds of decisions that are good for you.
Right. Yeah, I think that's exactly right. So health savings accounts are great for the healthy and the wealthy.
There you go.
If you don't have a lot of money, or if you're sick, not such a great deal. And what they actually do is they allow people to put their money aside and get tax benefits from it. So it's another way of getting tax benefits to folks who have enough money to be able to put it aside into special accounts to spend on healthcare. So there's a lot of people who have asked the question about the state of the insurance marketplaces and whether plans are pulling out or whether plans will continue to sell in those marketplaces. And so I was wondering if you could talk about that a little bit.
Well, we are seeing insurance companies pull out of these marketplaces, these exchanges across the states. Part of that is just the uncertainty. They don't know what the future is going to bring for them. And these are, in most cases, for-profit companies that have a fiduciary responsibility to return equity to their shareholders. So they have to make good business decisions. That's what that's their first responsibility. Second, it's to provide good products for their insureds. So it's the uncertainty. That's, if insurance companies hate anything, it's uncertainty. A bad law, they can learn to live with. The uncertainty of what the laws are going to be, they can't. So what they have to do in that case is price their products to weigh the options of potentially what could happen. So, you know, we could cut to the chase and say, here's what really ought to be happening. We ought to be having a serious discussion around a single payer system. I don't care.
Even I'm afraid to go there.
I think ultimately where we'll be is the most equitable is a single payer. And the insurance companies, I think, see the writing on the wall. I think that's why you're seeing these merger attempts. Now, two of them, one was denied, the other they pulled back from. But I think that in our country, what it would look like is they would be the third-party administrators of a system that is funded through payroll tax, like Medicare, is then administered by these companies who certainly know how to administer claims and provide all of the back office expertise that's needed. So I think we'll continue to nibble around the edges of health reform until we realize that there really are no easy solutions. You need everyone in the system. They're now talking about repealing the mandate. So that is a real problem for the companies, because then who buys coverage? Only people who know they need it. Older, sicker, younger, sicker folks. That causes the products to become very unaffordable and the marketplace becomes unsustainable. So if we're going to do away with the mandate, then how do you find a system that's equitable? Well, if you do it through payroll tax, everybody's paying in. You provide an opportunity for folks then to purchase the kind of healthcare coverage they want, and they could still buy varying tiers of coverage, but the underpinning of it would be the risk that the insurance companies now have to price for. That means they have to, that uncertainty that's out there, they have to figure out what that uncertainty is going to cost them, and they have to price for it, meaning they're going to be pricing it higher than perhaps is needed just to cover that uncertainty. They don't want to be the risk bearers in this healthcare system anymore. They do not want to be the risk bearers. If the federal government then becomes the risk bearer, they're the ones that pay for the care based on the care that's needed, and as we begin to control the cost through these accountable care organizations, you know, we can bring that whole system under a more rational and thoughtful and effective delivery system. But I don't see an ultimate solution that really gets us where we want to be until we finally grapple with having the government be the risk-bearing entity and having the insurance companies making money off of claims management and claims processing, which is much more doable for them, much more manageable, much more predictable, and in the long run, more effective for everyone.
I once had an insurance company executive tell me, we don't take risk, we manage risk.
That is very true. Yeah. They manage it by, charging more than perhaps they think they need even to offset those uncertainties that they can't predict.
And so when talking about the mandate, you reminded me that maybe we ought to zoom out a little bit. To give people some context to understand what I think we ought to talk about next, which is what we might see coming down the road, and to sort of illustrate the box that Congress has put itself in, and the corner it's put itself in as it tries to look at alternatives to this. And so earlier you said that the ACA was kind of not thrown together haphazardly. It was actually pretty well considered. And it's built on what we call the three-legged stool. And so the most popular part of the law, and the part of the law that everybody promises they're going to keep, is the idea that people with pre-existing conditions can still be able to buy insurance. Because previously, insurance companies could essentially choose their customers. And if they thought you were going to cost them money, they could choose not to sell a policy to you. So that's very popular. Everybody thinks that folks who have poor health status or pre-existing conditions should be able to buy insurance. The Republicans in Congress have promised that they're going to keep that. But of course, just keep in mind as an aside that the idea of a high risk pool is absolutely counter to that promise. But, so fine, insurance companies are actually okay with selling policies to everybody as long as they can be assured that everybody will be in the system, both healthy people and sick people, so they can spread the risk. And so you have to have something like a mandate for people to buy insurance in order for that to happen. If you didn't have something like a mandate, I mean, imagine this. I could not buy insurance, wait till I get sick, and then go to buy an insurance policy. That would be like buying a homeowner's policy while your house is on fire. And insurance companies cannot...
People, by the way, have tried that. Yeah. It's backdate checks, you know, checks in the mail.
So, you know, the health equivalent of that is calling Blue Cross Blue Shield while you're in the back of the ambulance on the way to the hospital. Now, insurance companies can't survive if that happens. And so they have to have some way to ensure that people are in the system. Now, the way that was chosen to do it was the way that Governor Romney had adopted in Massachusetts, which was a mandate that said, with a few exemptions, you must be insured. It's not necessarily the only way to do it. Other proposals that have been floated have a continuous coverage requirement, so that if you maintain coverage continuously without any breaks, an insurance company would have to sell you a policy. If there's any breaks, then they would not. I mean, there's obvious problems with that you can think of. You lose your job, you lose your insurance for a month, and all of a sudden you're out in the cold. There is even a policy that was floated that I don't think is going to go anywhere in this Congress that would actually pre-enroll everybody in insurance with then the ability to opt out if they didn't want to buy insurance. That was a little too heavy-handed, I think.
Switzerland does that. You don't buy it, they buy it for you, right, and send you the bill.
That's right. We can talk about other countries, too, because that's interesting. But, so you have to have some way to make sure everybody's in the system. That's the most unpopular part of the law. That's the part that's crimping our freedom and all that stuff. A mandate, however you do it, creates a third problem. Insurance is really expensive. Most people cannot afford it on their own. And so if you're going to have a pre-existing condition, a prohibition against exclusions for pre-existing condition, and therefore some sort of a mandate to make people buy insurance, you have to have some sort of system that subsidizes people for buying that insurance. And that's kind of the third leg of the stool. That's also unpopular because that costs a lot of money. And what the Affordable Care Act does to pay for that, it has a lot of taxes in it. It taxes medical device companies, it taxes insurance companies, it taxes folks with high income in order to fund the subsidies for everybody that has to come into the system. Now, the proposals that are being floated in Congress right now and that were outlined, I was going to say detailed, but they haven't been detailed yet, Congressman Ryan's plan the other day gets rid of all those taxes. And so they provide tax relief largely to wealthier people, but then eliminates all the money that's available to fund any sort of subsidies. And so that's a big piece of the Republican alternative that is missing right now. They acknowledge that they have to subsidize folks. They propose to craft the subsidies in a little different. In the ACA, they're based on income. In the Republican plan, they would be based on age, with the idea that older people, insurance costs more, so they get higher subsidies. Younger people, insurance costs less, they get lower subsidies. But of course, that means if you're old and poor, you still may not be able to buy a policy. But they have no way yet to come up with the money to pay for that. Those are some of the boxes they put themselves in. It's very hard to deliver on the promise to put everybody in the system and not exclude people with pre-existing conditions, but then say, we're not going to have a mandate. or we're not going to have subsidies. And so, I don't know, Sandy, if you have any more details on that, or could talk a little bit more about what the proposals are on the table.
Well, you know, I want to make one distinction too. We can joke about when the house is burning, you know, buying insurance. Homeowners and auto insurance are different than health insurance. Health insurance really isn't insurance. It's a prepaid medical plan. Not very many hands went up when Sheldon asked about how many of you have filed a claim on your auto insurance. But all of us use our health insurance. We use it for wellness visits. So it really is, I think, our mindset, and Congress needs to get its mind away from it being like auto and home, and more recognize that it's a prepaid medical, and it really is related more to social policy than it is to protecting homes and autos. It's an important part of the fabric of what makes us a society. It's that important part of taking care of each other and making sure we do that collectively as a society. And maybe they. Maybe if they could start thinking of it in those terms, I'm not hopeful, but it is different than auto and home. It is different. It is something we all use even when we're not sick. It doesn't relate to being sick, it relates to providing good health care, not sick care. That's been the problem in the past. You know, I've heard members of our legislature say, well, people can get care. They don't need to have insurance. They can go to the emergency room and they can get care. Well, that's not health care. That's sick care. And the rest of us pay for that. So that notion that you can get care in the emergency room as a way of receiving your health care services is just a fallacy, a major fallacy. So some of the other I do have. Go ahead.
Okay, so I have a brief summary of what the proposal is that was floated this week by Speaker Ryan in Congress. This is really a rehash of the plan that he's had out for a couple of years, and I think it was produced because Congress is on recess and folks are going home for town hall meetings. They need talking points. And this will actually, I think, segue us into Medicaid expansion, which is what I want to talk next. And so very briefly, what Speaker Ryan's plan would do is it would get rid of the mandate, as Sandy already said. It would change the tax credits from income-based to age-based, but again, there's no details yet on how much money we're talking about for folks of different ages. It would eliminate all of the taxes that fund the Affordable Care Act. And I would also point out that those taxes also go to fund things, changes in the Medicare program, like closing of the donut hole in the prescription drug program. And there's been no discussion of what happens with programs like that.
And Medicare for the first time offering an annual wellness visit, which it didn't in the original Medicare program, didn't have, that was included.
It would allow much higher tax-deferred contributions to health savings accounts, which we talked about already. It will create high-risk pools, which we talked about already. It does not propose any changes to Medicare, other than the ones that are embedded in the Affordable Care Act, because I think even though Speaker Ryan would like to see a voucher system in Medicare, I think he's smart enough to know that that's probably too big to bite off at this point. And there are no details, of course, on what the costs would be or how any of it would be paid for. Another part of the plan would be an elimination of the Medicaid expansion. And so let me explain what that is, and that will get us right into what's going on here in Kansas on that issue. And so the Affordable Care Act really had two ways for people to get insurance coverage. For people above the poverty level, they would go into the Affordable Care Act marketplace, and based on their income, get subsidies and tax credits to help them buy plans. And I should point out that another thing that's often not talked about is The Affordable Care Act did not fundamentally change anything for people who are in government programs like Medicare or Medicaid or the Armed Forces or the Veterans Administration. Did not fundamentally change anything for people who get insurance from their employers. That's the vast majority of people. What we're talking about is the individual non-group insurance market, which is a very small slice of the market. And so for folks who don't get insurance from a government program or don't get insurance from their jobs, there was a new marketplace that allowed them to make comparisons among plans and get subsidized for buying care. For folks below the poverty level, states were to expand their Medicaid programs to cover those people. Medicaid is a program that covers some low-income people. And one of the hardest things I've had to do as I speak to legislators in Kansas is convince them that everybody in poverty is not in the Medicaid program. Medicaid program is very selective. It covers certain categories of people depending on their income. So if you're a parent, you're eligible at a certain income level. If you're disabled, you're eligible at a certain income level. If you're a pregnant woman, you're eligible at a certain income level. Those levels are all different. What you get is a very complicated program. And the states largely set those rules, and they split the cost of the program with the federal government. So what the Affordable Care Act said to states was expand your Medicaid programs, cover everybody below the poverty level, and we, the federal government, will pay for nearly all the costs. So right now, Medicaid is essentially a 50-50 split between states and the feds. Here in Kansas, the state pays 44% of the cost. And that split varies. It's 50-50 in the wealthier states. It goes all the way to 75% federal funding in the poorer states in the country. Kansas is kind of right in the middle. But states set their own eligibility levels. And so here in Kansas, we have a Medicaid program with very, very low eligibility levels. So let me give you a couple of examples. If you are an adult in Kansas and you're not a parent, you're not eligible, which means you could be unemployed, you could have no income. You cannot be in our program for low-income people. If you're disabled, you can have an income of about 75% of the poverty level, which is about $8,000 a year for an individual. If you are a parent, you must be below 33% of the poverty level qualify for Medicaid in Kansas, which we call CanCare. So let me give you an example of what that means. A single mom with two kids, very common family situation, cannot make more than about $6,800 a year and qualify for Medicaid, which means that if she works a minimum wage job half time, she makes too much. That's the reaction I always get when I tell this story. It's appalling. And it also means that we have given that person a disincentive to accept a job. Because if she were to be offered a minimum wage job, those jobs don't come with health insurance typically. Now she has a decision to make. Does she take the job and lose her health coverage? Or does she turn down the job so she can stay insured? And that decision, of course, will be informed by whether she needs health care or not. So we have created a very untenable situation for folks in that situation, a very difficult decision. The ACA offered us a way out. It said, expand that program, cover everybody under poverty, get rid of all those categories, and we, the federal government, will pay at least 90% of the bill. 31 states accepted that offer. Kansas and 18 others did not. Which means that in the last 3 years, we've given up more than $1.7 billion in federal funding that would have come into the state to pay for healthcare services. Which means that we have given up the opportunity to expand the healthcare system, create jobs, hire more people who would both work in healthcare and in all the industries that support healthcare. So you have to remember, when hospitals are taking care of more people, it's not only the hospital that needs more nurses and more lab techs, it's the restaurants around the hospital where the employees go out to eat. It's the company that cleans the linens for the hospital. They have more linens to clean. It would create a big economic stimulus. And in fact, that is what is happening in the 31 states that have expanded their Medicaid programs.
And just as an aside, because our current Medicaid eligibility is so low, we would have reaped an even greater benefit from participating than states that were already at maybe even 100%. There are states that their Medicaid program before the ACA were at 100 or 150%. I think even 200%, 225. So those states wouldn't have benefited nearly as much as we would have benefited because we are so low. We're fifth lowest, I believe. We're down there with Mississippi and Louisiana. And
Missouri's lower.
Missouri is lower. They're like, yeah. So, you know, our department, when the Affordable Care Act passed and we weren't getting much support in Kansas for educating, our department took on the task of going around the state and trying to help answer questions. And I remember an event at Johnson County Community College. There were 200 or 300 people there, and someone asked, they were asking questions about the Medicaid eligibility, and I said, well, the sad thing is, if we don't expand Medicaid, then we will have people that don't make enough to qualify for the exchange, because you had to be at 100% of the federal poverty level. And this gentleman raised his hand and said, ma'am, I think you misspoke. You said you didn't make enough to qualify for, and I said, no, I know it doesn't make sense, but you had to make at least 100% of the federal poverty level to be eligible to go on the exchange to buy a policy that would give you subsidies and tax credits.
Right, because the idea was that everybody above the poverty level would go to the marketplace and buy a plan. And nobody in Congress anticipated that any state would turn down this offer because it was such a good deal. So everybody under 100% of poverty would be covered.
Well, but then before the court decided that Medicaid was optional for the states. Yeah.
So what we have done here in Kansas by turning down this program is we've created a gap. We have about 150,000 people who make too much with the current Medicaid program, but not enough to qualify for tax credits and subsidies to buy private insurance. And those folks would all be covered if the state accepted this expansion. Another thing that we talk about a lot, because I've spent most of my time in the last year or so talking about this, traveled around the state to a lot of communities. Not as big an issue in a place like Lawrence or in Douglas County, but you go out to rural communities and you have rural hospitals that are literally on the financial edge, whose survival depends on this. And if those hospitals close, and we saw this happen in Independence last year, the hospital closed. And what has happened there is very typical of what happens in rural communities. I've worked in rural health most of my career. The hospital closes, the hospital is usually the first or second biggest employer in town. So you lose a lot of jobs. All the local doctors leave because doctors need a place to practice. And so in Independence, Kansas today, you have a town that still has primary care, but there are no local doctors. There are primary care physicians that are in town a day or two a week from other systems in surrounding communities. And if folks in Independence need to go to the hospital, they need to go usually to Oklahoma or to Southwest Missouri. So they're going out of state for the most part. That community will not attract new businesses because businesses will not move to communities that don't have a health system. And so essentially what you see is the death of rural communities. We have more than 30 hospitals in Kansas that are considered financially vulnerable. And those communities need this program, and so far we have passed it up. And so that kind of leads me to, if you pass the table outside, we actually have a bill in the Kansas legislature this year, it's House Bill 2064, to expand the Kansas Medicaid program, to allow Kansas to take advantage of this program. It was supposed to be voted on last week in the House Health Committee. They postponed that vote till Monday. And it's going to be very, very close. And so anything you can do to contact legislators on that committee, and I want to also back up, we don't have any, John Wilson, who's from Lawrence, is on that committee, and he's of course a supporter, and all the other local delegation is supportive of this. But we're gonna need everybody calling their legislators to make sure we can get this bill out of committee and continue this fight, because despite the fact that there's uncertainty in Washington, as we were talking about, we don't know how long this is gonna take in DC to change any of this. There's certainly no guarantee that Speaker Ryan's plan is going to be adopted. It actually has very little chance, at least in the Senate, to get adopted. And so Kansas still has an opportunity to participate in this, and we ought to take that opportunity.
Well, and our governor has frequently said, well, you can't count on the federal government to be there if we expand Medicaid. And unfortunately, with the discussion around the Ryan plan that potentially has a little bit of a reality check to it, because they're talking about moving it back to the traditional Medicaid share versus the 90-10 that's in the Affordable Care Act. So I would just say, when you're talking to members of the legislature, don't let them be swayed by that argument. We need to pass the CanCare expansion now. And for one reason, additional reason, is that potentially they could look to what kind of state support had been there for the Medicaid program, and if they decide to go to some sort of a block grant program. So we need to get as much money into our Medicaid program as we possibly can, so that if they decide to go with block grants, we can use that as some leverage.
And we got a question that kind of leads me into what some of the reasons you might hear against doing this are. And so I want to talk about a few of those and assure you that there's reasonable responses to them. So one of the things you'll hear the governor and opponents of this program say is that it puts able-bodied people ahead of the disabled for services. And so what this is about is, in Kansas, if you're disabled at a certain income level, you can be in the Medicaid program. Kansas years ago also chose to provide an additional set of services to people with disabilities called home and community-based services. And those services are designed to be provided, as the title tells you, in home and in the community, to keep people out of institutions, which are very, very high cost. It's actually a very cost-effective program. We have never funded it adequately in the state of Kansas, so we have many thousands of people on a waiting list for home and community-based services. Now, all those folks are getting medical services through Medicaid. The governor would like us to believe that somehow by providing Medicaid to more people, it would push these disabled folks out of the way and keep them from getting the other services they deserve. And as Sandy and I have talked about a lot, those things are not at all related. If the governor and the Kansas legislature were devoted to shutting down those waiting lists and getting those services, they'd find the revenue to fund that, and they do it. So don't let them tell you that quote-unquote able-bodied people would move to the front of the line. Yes, a lot of the people that would be covered in this program are quote-unquote able-bodied. The other thing they're trying to get you to believe by using that language is code. They're trying to get you to think that these are lazy people who just want to sit around and take advantage of government programs. The fact is that the large majority of them are working, or in working families, or home raising kids. People do want to work if jobs are available, and that's certainly been our experience in the program. Another thing you're going to hear, and Sandy already alluded to it, is you can't trust the federal government to keep their promises. We, of course, in the state of Kansas, trust the federal government to keep their promises on lots and lots of other programs. Most people don't realize that 30% of the Kansas state budget is made up of federal dollars. We trust the federal government every day. The governor himself has floated many other health care proposals that rely on government funding to work. And so the idea that you can't trust the feds to keep their promise, I think, is nonsense. You'll also hear that, well, what difference does it make if the feds pay for it? It's still taxpayer money. And I think that's a good point. I agree with that 100%. Every one of us is a federal taxpayer. How many of you have seen your federal taxes go down because we have not accepted Medicaid expansion? Exactly. So we are sending money to Washington. Washington is offering to give some of it back. And we're saying, no, thank you. We're saying, that's okay, send our money to California, send it to Colorado, send it to New York, to those other states that have been wise enough to accept this program. And so all these arguments are just things they float out there. They're talking points. They're not very well thought through. We just really have to be able to punch through that and to get Kansas legislators and the governor to understand this is something that's good for Kansas. This is our tax money that we want to bring home to help us here in our state, which is really what we elect them to do, right? To support Kansas. And with that, I think we are about out of time. And so, you have anything to add, Sandy? I feel like I've done a lot of the talking.
Oh, that's why I like being on a panel with you, Sheldon. You're such a wealth of knowledge. You know, there is a point about the Medicaid program, and I remember this when I was in the legislature. the legislature does not decide that we're going to fund it at 32% of the federal poverty level. It's a number that's backed into. This is how much money they're willing to put up. And then you go back and calculate, well, what is the level of poverty that equates to? And I think it's perhaps allowed for a little bit of a shielding of reality in terms of what are we doing with our Medicaid program. We're not talking about that level of where we need to be. We're just talking about the amount of dollars, and it's easy to kind of get confused with when you're talking dollars. It's much more to the point when you're looking at percentage of the federal poverty level. And maybe that's what has confused some. We're lucky in Lawrence. I mean, our delegation is solidly behind doing the right thing. But in some parts of the state, maybe they just get confused by the dollar amount and aren't thinking about the actual level of poverty that this is funding, because they don't set it. They put the dollars in and then calculate what the poverty level is after the fact.
And I'll just add to that, but the last comment is that I think there's also a knowledge problem. I feel like I'm picking on the legislature a lot, and certainly I'm excluding our own great legislators from this, but a lot of legislators don't understand that. They don't understand that they have the power to fund this program at any level they want. I often have legislators say to me, why would we want to expand Medicaid? It's a program that doesn't pay providers very well, so a lot of providers don't participate. And I'll say to them, well, you know, you're in control of that. You can pay providers more. And I often get, I can?
Well, they understood when they did an across-the-board 4% cut that they had the authority to do that.
So we need to just keep educating our legislators. They have a lot of control over this. It's their choices that have both put us in the situation we're in and can solve a lot of these problems. And I think that's a great note to leave.
Just a final comment on that score. Medicaid has always been a state-federal partnership. We have always had the ability in Kansas, and every state has had the ability to tailor it to be what works for their state. So when they talk about, well, it's a federal program, it's a state program that is federally funded partially, but the state sets its rules.